Hello and welcome to another episode of Tales from a Professional Nerd. My name is Brian C.P. Steele, and I will be your nerd today and every other day that you choose to watch one of my shows or my TikTok or find me on some random thing that I might have lurking on the internet that I don't know is still there. Hello, how are you today? It waits for response. Great, I'm glad to hear it. Or, alternately, if you're having a bad day, I'm sorry, I hope it gets better. All right, now that that's out of the way, let's roll right into the weekend, Brian, because I'm gonna try and blur through the weekend, Brian, because I have got so much going on right now in my both personal and professional life. It's getting into the holidays. You'll hear here in a few minutes one of the things that's finally coming to a close. Life is pretty rushed, and it's one of the reasons why today's episode is going to be an opinion piece. Not that any of these aren't opinion pieces, maybe with a couple of facts sprinkled in here and there, but we'll get to that in a minute. First and foremost, work stuff. Work stuff has been fantastic. I'm waiting on some files and some editorial notes for some Warzone stuff for the Warzone Eternal main rulebook. However, over on the Warzone Eternal Facebook page, which is still technically unpublished, but has a ton of people on it, which is really kind of cool that there's so many fans that they jumped onto that page before ResNova officially made like an actual, like, we're making this game announcement. You know, obviously everyone knows about it, and yes, we've talked about it, and yes, we've made the kind of, you know, non-advertising, non-marketing savvy advertisements about it, but, like, it's never officially been like, okay, hey, this is what is gonna happen, and this is when it's gonna happen. Everything has been a lot of, hey, figurative, where it's still in motion, everything's still being, being put together. Here's some samples, but not like, you know, none of this stuff is done. And this last week, the artist, I am actually going to look him up real quick because I do not want to misname him, as that would be for real rude. I don't want to be that guy. So give me one second. I'm just going to fill the air with my chatter. His name is Dan Morrison. Dan Morrison, which is at Dark Mechanic on Twitter, has put out some sketchwork and artwork pieces that are going to be in the Warzone Eternal rulebook. Very cool stuff. I love the fact that Alex and ResNova are doing new art with a Bonner style, but with a little bit more of today's stylization, so it's that way it matches up to the models and stuff that we're creating. I love the you know, taking an old piece of art, an old image, an old concept, and tweaking it just a little bit to match the current aesthetic. So that way the fans get that same awesome stuff that has been with us for years, but they get a new version, new poses, new scenes, new things like that, instead of recycling the same art again and again and again. So, totally rad, super happy about it. Not to mention, it means that when you see some of these art pieces, if they're a little bit different than what you're used to, than what you remember from seeing the old pieces, if you're an old fan of old Warzone stuff, it gives you a good idea of kind of the art direction that Alex is going with in order to make these models old feel, new tech. So I'm really happy with it. You should go check it out. I know that somebody posted a bunch of it onto the Warzone Eternal Facebook page, but I think you would be doing a better service if you actually went to Dan's Twitter, gave him a follow, make a comment, say, hey, you know, super cool, great artwork, can't wait to see more, you know, that sort of thing. So yeah, Warzone stuff's going great. Commission painting's going great. Actually talked with a client about the paint schemes he wants me to do on some Imperial Guard and Thousand Suns stuff. So that'll be a lot of fun. Just finished up that Puppet Wars commission for my buddy in South Carolina, which he actually should be receiving in the mail maybe today. So that might be kind of cool. I might be getting a call later that says, whoa, this stuff came in. I just hope that the mail service treated it well and everything. I packed it well, gave the bubble wrap, gave it the wrap. So I'm hoping everything gets to him, you know, unscathed. And then, obviously, my primary work source right now is all my role-playing work through Renegade Games. Still putting the final touches on that that Transformers adventure arc. It's shaping up. It is difficult. I won't lie. It is difficult to try and make a deep non-combat encounter when you're dealing with giant robots that turn into vehicles. But it's fun. I'm having a good time, and I'm hoping that when people get this adventure arc, that there is enough of a sprinkling of both, of, you know, social encounters and non, you know, blasting and maybe some vehicle encounters and stuff like that. I'm hoping that the players like the diversity of the scenes and encounters, because it'd be real easy just to basically slap it in and be like, all right, here's another combat, fight this guy. But not only does that get old after a while, it can be really discouraging if you're not playing a combat heavy character. And so I would rather do a nice scope of things and get people to be able to do lots of things, rely on different members of the team. So as I always put it at my table, share the spotlight, so to speak. And then, I got to see I'd say about 85% done cover art to my latest Shadowrun novel. So it's almost complete. Very happy with the direction that it's going in as far as the art goes. It always makes me happy when I see, because I am not that kind of artist. I'm not a painter. I am not a line artist. It always, I get gushy. I'm like, nee! Whenever I see characters I've created or concepts I've created that I've described in an art brief realized in pencils and color and things like that. And so to take a cover with four characters that I, you know, poured 85,000 words worth of love into, to see them brought to life through an artist's eyes based off of my art brief, it's rad. I got nothing better to, you know, to say. The only thing that I would love more is if some of the NPCs or co-stars of that book, if I could get art for them, because I'd love to kind of see what people did for that. But who knows, maybe the book will take off and people will do fan art. Who knows? That, or maybe one of you guys will do fan art and show me on the channel, and I will put it up and go, look at this great artist doing this thing. But yes, that's basically been the week in Brian for work-wise. You'll have to excuse me, I'm a little bit manic today. I'm heavily caffeinated. I'm moving hard. I also slept in, which never happens. I won't even say that it was 100% by accident. When my alarm went off, I kind of sat there in my vibrating morning chair, and I kind of sat there and was like, I'm not ready to get up yet. I'll work late today, but I'm gonna sleep in today. And so that's exactly what I did. I slept in a little while longer. You know, took care of the animals, got everybody squared away. Speaking of which, let's see if we can get one in here. Johnny, hey, come here, bud. So I've got my dog. This is John. John's the alter ego for the Martian Manhunter. All of our pets have DC character names. Fanboy. Hi, buddy. But John, the reason why he's in here today is John started some new meds. He's got some pretty gnarly skin issues. Okay, you can lay back down, buddy. He has some pretty gnarly skin issues, and he chews himself up real bad. If he's not on a steroid, he started some new stuff earlier this week, and it, sadly, it has some adverse side effects where Lay back down, pal. Let me wake you up. Don't eat my dirt out of the plant, please. No, don't eat dirt. It's one of the adverse side effects is he has some kidney and bladder control. Not to be too graphic, but sometimes if he gets, run around too excited or whatever, and someone isn't available to like let him outside immediately, because he'll give you a warning. He'll walk up and go, hey, I'm gonna pee, and then suddenly, you've got a 75-pound, actually, I think at this point he's put on a little weight, he's probably 85 or 90, monster wetting the living room floor. So I've got him in here in order so if he needs to let me know, if he needs to hop out to the back, that he'll let me know, and then we'll pause the video and I'll go take care of that and come back. You'll get a fun little dog break edit. Dog break. But yeah, so I was saying, what was I saying? Talking about, I totally lost my train of thought. Talking about animals and such. All right, I don't remember what where we were going with that, but yeah, so work stuff is coming through, everything great. Game wise, I got to play the Curse of Strahd. Oh no, I got to play my friend's game in his world, his homebrew world called Menhiriath. I got to play Sal Sobersbane, my halfling tavern fighter brawler, drunken monk style. We had a great time. We had a blast. We're starting to uncover some plots within plots and secret things. And a guy came to our characters and was like, "My boss is, I think my boss is a bad guy, and please, you need to come check it out, come to the house tonight." And we get there, and sure enough, the guy who told us to come to the house, yeah, he was right. His boss is a schmuck and needed to be dealt with. The guy who actually told us to come to the house and deal with this problem or whatever is one of the big bad guy NPCs that we've been looking for, but he was in disguise, and so it was pretty cool. I enjoy playing that character a lot. He is laid back enough that I get to make a lot of jokes. I get to kind of be part of the comic relief of the table, and I do enjoy that so long as it's not disruptive. But he is also useful enough as far as like skills and abilities that I don't feel like, oh, as soon as this scene starts, I'm pointless. He's a good mix of the two, and I had a great time, and I love playing with I love getting to play with those guys. Now that everybody's like vaccinated and COVID is less of an issue in that circle. Super excited about that. Other game wise, playing some new Sea of Thieves stuff, cool new stuff for Sea of Thieves. Also, I don't think I've mentioned this, saving it for a future episode. But my wife and I are going to go, we're going to do Satine's Quest. Satine Phoenix is a friend of ours, and she's doing a D&D cruise, a gamer cruise, with a bunch of cool celebrity DMs and stuff that are gonna run some tables. And honestly, Natalie and I, despite several false starts, despite having money saved up to do so but never getting a chance to actually pull the trigger on it, we're finally getting to take our honeymoon. After 5 years of being married. And so that's what this is. Natalie has said multiple times that she really enjoys role playing. She loves playing D&D. It's something that I introduced her to, but she doesn't get a chance to very often. There's not very many gaming groups that are not already full up or so, I mean, I hate to say this, but so incestuous that, they have the same group of players every time, and they don't want to bring on a new person, especially a new like untested, unskilled. I hate to say that, but you know what I mean. Like, if you've got six spots at the table, five of them are veteran players that have been playing for 30 plus years, and you bring in a brand new person, it's awesome. It's an awesome experience to be able to teach somebody and mold them and shape them in how things go. But it also takes a certain amount of patience, that some gamer people don't have, especially old grognard gamers. A lot of times they just don't. They just don't. So we were like, you know what? Let's do this. And not only will it get a chance for me and Natalie to play together as players, which we never have. I'm always a DM for with her. But it allows us to also, I'm happy for her because she's going to get to play at other people's tables, some really high class quality DMs. She's going to be able to see how some other people run their games, experience, different levels of immersion and rules crunch, and I'm just really excited. I think it's a great way. I think that it's gonna be the gamer version of throwing somebody in a pool, but full of lifeguards. I'm really excited. I think it's gonna be very cool. But to say that we made our characters for the cruise, and I'm really happy for her. I think not only is she navigating D&D Beyond and navigating character creation really, really well. She's really putting a lot of thought into the character, into the process, and what she wants to do. I hope that this gets ingrained enough that, like, maybe she'll take this character to some other games, or maybe she'll start coming to some of the game conventions with me to help get over some of her anxieties and play with outsiders. Maybe she'll be able to use this character again in another Satine's quest vacation that we might take in the future, or a special event at like GaryCon or something like that. Either way, I'm just again super excited. So sponsory stuff. Oh, I forgot the one of the I was talking about the one of the important parts of Week of Brian, the reason why I'm kind of blurring through a lot of this stuff. So weight loss journey, still sitting at around 40 pounds. 40 pounds lost. I can't seem to, I mean, I'm sure a lot of it's the holidays. We just had Thanksgiving. We have my kid's birthday this last weekend. Natalie's birthday is this upcoming weekend. Then we have a family Christmas. I have a lot more planned cheat days in the next like 5 weeks than I really wish. So I've just really got to try and stay on the straight and narrow and not lose a bunch of traction along the days between those holiday events. But I'm sitting right around 40, basically I balance between 40 to 42 pounds lost. So I'm trying to get there. Someone, Felix, actually one of the frequent commenters on the show, mentioned that I was looking like I was getting back down to Dark Age era Brian. A few years back, and you're right. I am sitting at around the same weight that I was when I left. When my employment was severed from CIMON, or CIMON, or Kuomintang, or not, however they want it to be said these days. It feels good. Hopefully this isn't TMI, but this morning after my shower. The f this was the first time in at least a year that I was able to put the towel, one of our shower towels, around my waist, tuck it, and walk from the bathroom to or from the shower to where I get dressed. The spot in our room is like next to my closet and stuff, without losing the towel. Without it kind of getting pushed out by my belly, and also not sucking in. So I was very happy. I still am. But then the other big life event that's happening right now, by the time this comes out, hopefully the ink will be dry on it, but the refinance on my home, taking advantage of much of the equity that we built into it to pay off a bunch of bills and things, is finally. After 6 months of fighting and changing companies and filling out every form that you can possibly imagine, calling in financial markers with friends of mine that owe money, or that I know that I can basically, you know, go into an endeavor with. Or like it has been an uphill battle over thumbtacks that were dipped in lemon juice. And I've done it. Unless something, knock on wood, unless something awful happens and some weird obscure rule pops up or something along those lines, by the time this video comes out, the refi will have gone through, the paperwork will have been signed, a ton of my debt will have been erased. You will note probably next week's video, I will have a lot less stress coming off of me if you could see those kinds of things. Because this week has been very, very stressful when it comes to that kind of stuff. Let's get into the sponsors and then get into the video. So sponsors, we'll say first and foremost, is I'm going to do it in opposite order because the third one kind of leads into the topic for today. My hobby sponsor, you know, whoop, Turbo Dork. They're amazing. I love them. They've got some of the best metallics and color shifting paints anywhere. They stand by their products 100%, and they're doing awesome holiday specials right now. And their website, obviously go to the, you know, link in my description. And their website, they're doing gift cards, which I've said this before, it is perfect. And there is nothing wrong with getting a hobbyist a gift card for hobby supplies. Because a lot of us, as hobby artists and things, we have particular tastes. And the last thing you want to do is get some, you'll spend a bunch of money on something for somebody that they're never going to use. Or get them something and then you go, "How cool is that?" And you get that little glimmer in their eye of, "Oh, okay." Much better to get them the option of choice. Let them know that you're still thinking about their hobby, their skills, their talent. You're still thinking about them using that, but you are also making sure that they get what they need and what they want. So turbodork.com. Sovereignty.com, a tabletop board game emulator. Love them to death. They have got some very, very cool stuff on there. My favorite to play still is Isle of Cats currently. I'm sure as they expand, I'll find a new favorite. They've got a sushi board game on there that also is a lot of fun. It's also really fast paced. So you can sit down and just like get a game in like 30 minutes. Super, super fun. And right now, if you use the sign up code TFAPN, TFAPN, Tales from a Professional Nerd, you get your first 60 days full platinum coverage or platinum service for free, which means you get to play with your profile, you get to change your avatar, you get to access to all of the games whenever you want. You can set up your own room so you can invite other people. And hell, have those other people use TFAPN as a code. Hopefully they're already, you're like, "Hey, be a subscriber on Brian's channel." But if not, that's fine. They can still use the code. I just prefer that they would go ahead and come listen and talk and share. And share. Then the last of my current sponsors, still working on that ghost, the ghostly food sponsor that has yet to materialize. I don't know if it's going to. They're a big company, and they sponsor a lot of podcasts and things that have like hundreds of thousands of viewers, and I'm still working on getting into the thousands. So, which needs you guys to share and tell people to subscribe. The bigger I get, the cooler stuff I can do. Now that I'm done scolding you for being a fan, my last sponsor and also my first sponsor, the one that's nearest and dearest to my heart, both figuratively and literally, is Armor Class 10. They are an apparel shop. They do amazing gamer and gamer related t-shirts, some nerd adjacent stuff like Star Trek, things like that. They hook me up with some cool shirts all the time, which is what I'm wearing right now. Now, you will look at this and you'll go, Is that backwards because of my thing? Well, no, you'll note Turbo Dork is forward. That's not backwards, that's Cyrillic. That's Russian. It is the word pozier. Or pozier? I did the Google Translate play thing just because I didn't want to sound like an idiot. Too late. So this is the Russian word for poser. And it is a reference to a fun conversation that happens between Black Widow and her little sister in the Black Widow movie. Basically, her little sister comments about why, you know, I've seen you on the news, I've seen you in clips. Why do you do that silly superhero landing, like the outline on this cool T-shirt? And why do you take a pose? Why does, you know, what is the purpose of that? You're such a poser. And then in the movie, there is a moment where the little sister basically pulls a Black Widow, does the pose, and gets mad at herself for doing so, and then goes, ugh, poser. So Armor Class 10 took that moment to make a really cool shirt, a very cool Marvel Universe shirt that is obviously talks about, you know, for someone who's sporting the Black Widow, which was a great movie, by the way. I didn't review it here just because it didn't hit me as super bad, so I didn't want to come and rant about it, and it didn't hit me as super amazing, so I didn't want to spend an entire episode talking about, you know, the little things about it. What I will say this is that I'm not going to spoil it for anybody who hasn't seen it. I hated the twist. I thought the twist was stupid. And their treatment of Taskmaster is appalling. He is a great character in the comics. He's an amazing sideline character, and we get one really good Taskmaster-esque fight that uses a lot of his abilities and things in the movie. And then from there on out, he's effectively a throwaway plot message that is tragic, in my opinion. And changes were made to the character that were utterly unnecessary. It's, again, I understand certain aspects of Hollywood and what they do to make things new and exciting. I've always been a proponent of, if you're just changing something in order to change it, what's the purpose? Why? Why are, if literally you're just like, ha ha ha, I want to make this different, all you're going to do, new fans that have never seen the character before aren't going to know any better, and old fans that have seen the character, all you're doing is basically telling them that, you know, they're not getting the version of the character that they want. So I'm not going to rant about that. I'm done with that. But that's one of the reasons why I didn't do a Black Widow review. However, I do love this shirt because I do love that aspect of the movie. I did enjoy the movie. I thought it was a good movie. But it ties into today's topic, which is the Hawkeye Disney Plus series review, up through episode 4. It is only I hate the fact that Disney Plus is only giving us a 6-episode arc. I hope that means we're going to get another season very quickly, and that this isn't just a way for them to pass the torch. Because this is probably some of the best Marvel, some of the best Marvel character realization that they've done, especially in the Disney Plus series. Is the only thing that I think that was probably better so far is Falcon and Winter Soldier. Falcon and Winter Soldier was an amazing take with all kinds of, you know, hard impacting sociopolitical, you know, things, which this has as well. But one of the things that Hawkeye is doing is, it's taking a main character. Hawkeye is one of the main Avengers and has been since we first met him in Thor. It's taking this character that has always taken not even a back seat, but like riding sidecar in the follow-up motorcycle. Like Hawkeye has been overlooked as a very cool character for a very long time. And we got some spoilers, obviously. We got some of that with his all too brief introduction as Ronin in Endgame, but then we do get a lot of really cool, there's some family building, some characterization stuff in with the him his the scene between him and Black Widow in Endgame as well. But it is really nice to give this character, to see this character shine. Because up until this point, he's basically been a backdrop to make other stuff happen. And in this instance, we're actually getting to see the plot does, yeah, it's around Kate Bishop, but it does have to do with him trying to get back to his family, living up with the bad decisions that he made during the blip. We get to see all the cool trick arrows that we know and love from the comics. They finally address and do it in an amazing way of updating the character to point out that he's completely deaf in one ear and almost completely deaf in the other, and it has to require a hearing aid to be able to hear. In the comics, that's a more long-standing thing, but in the MCU, they're going ahead and they're saying that, it's because he's human and he's been kicked and punched and exploded and zapped and, like there's all these things that have happened to him, and it's showing some wear and tear on a human body, which is awesome. It's great. I love that they found a way to come back to the comic, to refer back to the comic without just saying, oh, it's always been that way. Like they actually evolved this character, because I'm sure there's a ton of scenes in the past movies where we've seen that ear and there's not a hearing aid in it. I'm sure he's definitely responded to people on both sides of him without having to, look like he's reading lips or anything like that. So this is a really good way of saying, no, here's this character's physical difficulty, and he's finding a way around it. Or when it does come up as, oh man, something is happening, he does have a way to we see that affect him. It's great. It's great. So the reason I'm doing this review now, through episode 4, is episode 4 was probably 1, 2, and 3 were great. Don't get me wrong. They were great episodes. They're fantastically well written. I love pretty much all of the characters, even I am a DC fanboy from way back. I like my superhero movies to feel more like the comics, even if that means that they are deep and dirty and dark. I like them to be more on the realistic side of things. I know you shouldn't say that when you're dealing with comic books, but whatever. Unless that they're designed to be more on the fantastical or more of the magic side of things. And I give the MCU a lot of hell. I really, really do. Because I do not care for a lot of the let's lighten this up, let's lighten the mood with a poorly placed one-liner, or let's change this character completely because, he's too dark otherwise. Let's go ahead and take one of the most powerful characters in the MCU or in Marvel Universe altogether and dumb them down for a stupid toddler gag. I really have a hard time with when the writers over at the MCU do that kind of stuff. If it's well placed and it's well deserved, fantastic. If it is ruining an otherwise deep moment, I don't like it. I don't care for it, and it helps. It makes the movie hard for me to watch. What if the Disney Plus series did? I'll start at the beginning. WandaVision was okay. I enjoyed parts of it. I thought it took forever to get to where it needed to go and start telling us plot. I do not understand why everybody would, other than Catherine's acting, which was fantastic. I do not understand why Agatha Harkness is getting her own show. It seems like just complete fan service. It's like, we made a funny music video about this character, and she was the hidden bad guy. I don't get it. I thought that, within the confines of the WandaVision idea, sure, her own show, I don't know, especially now that she's trapped in whatever. Photon, the Ms. Marvel adjacent, God, I can't remember, Robao? I can't remember the character's real name, but she'll end up being known as Photon. I loved her arc. I loved how they did it. I loved how they described it. I loved that she has some major blip trauma. And I love how they gave her powers. That like it wasn't, she's not just a mutant. She wasn't an experiment. Wanda. There's stuff that happened, and I dig it. I thought that I can really see that character going far, and I'm glad to hear that apparently she's going to be in the Marvels, which is the Captain Marvel sequel. And so far, I think she's probably going to be my highlight of it. I can't stand Kamala Khan. I think embiggening power on a is silly. I think she looks silly. She's a plastic man in the DC, even when they darkened up his background, is still slapstick humor. Reed Richards can be the smartest guy in the world, and the only time that he's believable is when he's not stretching. Stretching power is silly. It is. I'm sorry. Growing and shrinking with density and selling Ant-Man stuff, super cool. But being able to grow big fists, I don't know. I am not a fan. Not to mention, I do believe that they are going to overham that character to basically dis to reach out Disney-fi for a particular audience. And I'm just not here for it. Not to mention, I thought the original Captain Marvel was not that great. Brie Larson did an okay job with a boring character. I understand that there's a lot of people who really, really loved that movie, and a lot of people flag wave for it because of what it represents, and I think that's fantastic. The little girls that want that see Captain Marvel and go, that's super rad, and I think that is a very cool thing. I just wish that the movie was better written, and that it wasn't, that the character of Captain Marvel, who is an amazing character in the comics, wasn't just used as a MacGuffin in Infinity War and Endgame, because that's really all she was. They could have really done a lot more with that character, and instead she was a sideline cut scene to lead into one of the most ham-fisted scenes that I've ever seen. And then at the end of the movie, it's like, all right, I gotta go, see you later. Whoa! I just don't care for it. I think that that is an amazing character that is being very poorly written. I don't know. Do with that what you will. So that's the whole WandaVision aspect of things. I thought the show was okay. It just took forever to get to where it needed to go. Falcon and the Winter Soldier was amazing. It hit on all levels. I loved seeing some of the trauma that Bucky is dealing with, and I loved the socio-political message of Sam, of Falcon, having to basically, he's trying to save his family's boat. He's trying to save his, he's trying to keep the farm, so to speak. And being an Avenger isn't a job. It's not like being War Machine, where he's a member of the army. It's not like, Tony, who owns a company. How he gets by on a day-to-day basis is what, like, his military pension? It makes you think, and it has an it which when we get to Hawkeye, it has an amazing message on the flip side of that coin. And not to mention, I thought that it was a great way to show how the American people sometimes get behind a symbol more than the person's actions, until it becomes untenable. And I loved the U.S. agent aspect of things. No, it just it was really good. I liked the throwback to Batroc. Seeing him return, I liked, even though Steve wasn't in it, even though the real Captain America wasn't in it, we got so many references to, I'm not a super soldier. We were reminded about just how amazing Steve Rogers was, that because there were so many people trying to fight and live in his shadow, that it took reimagining the shield, so to speak, and Sam taking it up and going, no, I'm the new Captain America. Even though he's not a super soldier, even though he's not that he's brave enough, he's talented enough, and he's got the backing of good friends and family and things to represent that aspect of the character. It was great. I love the show. I love the show. I do think that there may have been some villain opportunities that didn't get fully flexed, and the change to Sharon's character. I'm hoping she's a Skrull. To be honest, I'm not a fan of where they took Sharon, but either neither here nor there. Then we get into What If, or well, actually, we get into Loki. Oh, Loki was good. It was a fun show. I am worried that the Loki show is all fan service, and a way for the Marvel writers to fast forward certain aspects of things. How we were introduced to Kang at the end. He wasn't Kang yet, but he is, but he's not. I don't know. I liked it. I think it left a lot of things unanswered and purposefully vague, so people will want to flock to movies. I think that it was basically a go check out these things in the movies, rather than a completely well-fabricated story of its own. But still good, still enjoyed it. What If had some very strong episodes, it had some very weak episodes, it had episodes that just were dumb. And I disagree. I know there's a lot of people who enjoyed it. I disagree tying it together and making it part of the MCU as a whole. And if that's one of the things that Phase 4 is leaning towards, it will disappoint me. Part of the beauty of What If is they were self-contained stories that didn't really mess with each other, that didn't really get into, it was a, this could be an alternate timeline that we never really looked at. I liked that a lot. It also allowed the What If writers to go nuts and just ignore all concepts of where things were going in order to make this really cool story without having to worry about it having any kind of impact or people going, man, I wonder if that's going to show up. I didn't think the last part was necessary. I think that you just tell cool stories, you make people happy to see their characters back doing different things, and then move on. And then we get Hawkeye. I hate the fact that it is only going to be 6 episodes, because it is one of the best stories that they're telling so far. Not only do we get to see it, again, a lot like Sam with Falcon, we get to see the other side of what being an Avenger is like. And the other side of this coin, you know, a lot of people will be able to point out, well, maybe it is a, you know, African-American versus Caucasian thing, you know, the white privilege shining through. We see all these people bending over backwards for Hawkeye as an Avenger. You know, oh, there's an Avenger in the audience. Oh, there's an Avenger here. Oh, there's, you know, you saved the city. You don't have to, you know, pay for that. Sam helped save the world and can't get a loan. Hawkeye takes his kids out for Chinese food and they're like, no, don't pay for this. You know, we've got this. You know, everybody, the brother, recognizes him, and he's just another white guy. You know, he's just another dude, but they recognize him. They know who he is. You know, he's known as an Avenger first and foremost, when he was basically a governmental assassin. You know, like, he was a hitter for the CIA. You know, like, S.H.I.E.L.D. sent him to kill people. And that's overlooked because of saving New York one day with his friends, with everyone could see. Sam has done all of that and more, is an active member of, you know, was an active army vet, helping other army vets with their post-traumatic stress, like, best friends with Captain America, like it, there's just all this really cool stuff, and he can't get a bank loan. In fact, he gets confused for a college football player. Like, there's so many things to say there. The action in Hawkeye is amazing. All the arrows, the shots, the things. The comedy is well placed. It's not super overdone. Ignore that beep. That's my 3D printer telling me that it's done. The comedy is well placed. It's not super heavy handed. I thought it might get a little stupid because the bad guys are the Tracksuit Mafia, which is kind of a silly thing from the comics. But they're just enough level of silly, and more importantly, because Echo is involved, because Kingpin is involved, we're able to look past their social ineptitudes, in order to, because we're feeling the loom of that greater picture. Plus, it is a really good counter to the dark aspects that we're getting in Hawkeye's personality. You know, for several years, because he lost his family in the blip, Ronan was a for-hire hitman. He went and killed bad people for money. He went and tracked down bad guys and dealt with them by murdering them. You know, Ronan was not a good guy. We don't get to see that in Endgame nearly enough, but Hawkeye became a hitman, a kind of ninja-themed hitman, and he's dealing with that because then suddenly his family, his moral center, his anchor comes back. The blip is over. Family is back, and now he's got to look at them and go, I killed dozens of people because of my sense of loss when you were gone. And now that you're back, I can't take back the people I've killed. I can't take back my murders. I can't overlook the fact that those people are dead. They have families that miss them. And my loss has been undone, with the exception of my best friend who sacrificed herself when I was trying to sacrifice myself when I was dealing with my loss, and so forth and so on. And he just, throughout this season, he just keeps getting reminded about it. You know, between the silly musical in the beginning, to you know, people bringing up Natasha, to you know, his new relationship with Kate Bishop, the soon to be the new Hawkeye, another Hawkeye, if you will. And you know, we see the pain in his face. We see the loss that he suffered that no one can understand. No one can possibly know what it's like to be ready to give up your life and then have someone step in your way and go, "No, you've got more to live for. I'm gonna do this." There's just nothing, you know, to literally have your best friend martyr themselves for you to survive and hopefully have a redemption arc when you don't believe you deserve one is such a heavy thing. And Jeremy Renner is killing it. The pain in his face, the tears in his eyes, the look that he if someone if someone told me that Jeremy Renner, I did not know that he had true theatrical background, but I learned that he does. He used to do Shakespeare. I absolutely see it. I 100% see all that stage acting coming, just shining through him. And it's beautiful. I love the fact that, you know, he has someone who lost his family, got them back, and is trying to get back to them to celebrate their first Christmas as a family post blip. You know, like to return to that. And then his protege, his partner, his friend, whatever, is actively running away from her family. Because, you know, yeah, she's dealing with the loss of her father, but she can't stand the fact that her mom's got this new fiance. She's running actively into danger. You know, she's basically shrugging, "Oh well, you know, I'll make it through this," because she's not, aside from her father, she has not witnessed that kind of impact, like what Hawkeye's been through. And so it's so good and it's so deep. And I think that we're gonna get more Kingpin. I know that we got, you know, some non-Vincent D'Onofrio cameo hand pinch cheeks. We're referencing the big guy a lot. I hope that Disney pulls the trigger and does bring him in. I hope that he's a cool, like, you know, season, you know, like end of season opener or end of season closing shot is Vincent behind a desk or something like that. Because I thought that Vincent D'Onofrio did an amazing job as Kingpin in the Netflix series. I would love to see him tied to this. I think that all of the trick arrows and the archery and things are great. Lucky the Pizza Dog is a fun comic reference that they didn't need to include him, but he's neat. You know, it's a nice way for the people who've read the Hawkeye comics to go, excellent. I have two, I'm not going to say complaints because I can't complain about this series. My number one complaint is that it's only 6 episodes long, as it feels like they are just using it as a bridge gap to another project. And that sucks. I want this to be its own animal, especially with how well written it is. And then my other complaint is that I feel this is becoming a passing of the torch story, where Clint wants to get back to his family and retire so he can hand his bow off, you know, theoretically to Kate, so she'll become the new Hawkeye. In this kind of new Avengers initiative, starring, you know, Sam and you know, the new Ms. Marvel and you know, all these things, like they were kind of getting to this whole young Avengers aspect of things. I am hoping that this amazing writing and this amazing depth and this amazing acting from Jeremy Renner does not get overlooked as simply a vehicle to bring Kate Bishop in. That we get to continue the same quality of story. Maybe we get more of the same. We get some more sidekick moment later on. I hope we get a season two that isn't just, oh, Jeremy is no longer involved, because he's just killing it so hard. And after all of the grief and all of the memes and all of the, oh, you're the guy with the bow, from the past 20 some odd Avengers Marvel MCU movements where Hawkeye got, you know, pardon the French, where Hawkeye got shit on. This is an amazing story and amazing acting and amazingly well written, and one of the things that I do not want is I don't want this to just be a send-off for the character. He does, you know, Jeremy Renner deserves better. The character deserves more. And I prefer, personally, while Kate Bishop is amazing, and I love that we're getting, you know, the actress is killing it. And I think that the on-screen portrayal of the character is great. And I can't wait for there to be a new Avengers initiative that has Kate Bishop, that has Black Widow's sister, that has Sam as the Captain America. I look forward to that as well. I just don't want to lose this powerful version of Hawkeye. And I don't mean powerful as in, ah! I mean powerful as in touching on my heartstrings, making me care about the character, that sort of thing. All right, well, I have jabbered on longer than I actually wanted to. I hope that you will, if you've got Disney Plus, check out Hawkeye and watch it through to the end like I'm going to, and maybe you'll feel the same way I do. Put your comments in the comment section about what you think. Just keep in mind that there's probably going to be a lot of spoilers because we're talking about spoilery stuff. You know, like, share, comment, subscribe. You know how that is. But personally, make sure that you stay safe, get vaccinated, get a booster if you can. I'm going to get mine very soon, as soon as I'm available to do so. More than anything, you know, enjoy yourself, put a smile on your face and someone else's face, and play some games. We'll see you next week.